Eating a high-fat diet could make you riboflavin deficient. Here's how to make sure that it doesn't. Hi, I'm Dr. Chris Masterjohn of chrismasterjohnphd.com, and this is Chris Masterjohn Lite, where the name of the game is details, schmetails, just tell me what works. And today we're going to talk about high-fat diets and riboflavin. So there are two aspects to this. The first is that fat does not contain any riboflavin. So the more fat you eat, the more you're displacing foods that do have riboflavin. That doesn't mean that you have to eat a low-fat diet in order to get enough riboflavin. It just means that to the extent that you include more fat in your diet, you need to be more careful that the rest of your diet is high in riboflavin-rich foods, because someone eating a low-fat diet could have a bunch of mediocre foods that just all have a little bit of riboflavin, and it all kind of adds up to enough. But if those are the types of foods you eat, and then you displace half of those foods with fat, you're pushing out a lot of that riboflavin. It becomes more important to take the other half of your diet and really put very riboflavin-rich foods into it. The other aspect to this is you actually need more riboflavin on a high-fat diet. Now, there's not really good human studies on this. There is at least one study where they put people on a higher fat diet and it increased their riboflavin a little bit, kind of like you would expect, but they didn't use very big differences in the fat and carbohydrate ratio, and they didn't show a very big effect. But what we can say from how we know riboflavin works in the body is you require almost twice as much riboflavin to burn fat as you do to burn carbohydrate. So when you go on the high-fat diet, you're pushing riboflavin out of the diet, and you're also proportionally increasing your need for riboflavin. To give a sense of what the magnitude might be of the effect of fat on the riboflavin requirement, some back-of-the-envelope calculations of mine suggest that if you started at a diet that was 30% fat and 60% carbohydrate, if you doubled the fat and in doing so, you took down the carbohydrate in proportion to wind up at 60% fat, 30% carbohydrate, that would increase your riboflavin requirement by about 25%. So if you are eating high-fat diet, then I would look back at the episode I did 3 episodes ago. I'll link to it in the description of this one on the signs that you might need more riboflavin and see if any of those apply to you. And then we'll talk about ways to work in riboflavin-rich foods 2 episodes from now. This episode is brought to you by Vitamins and Minerals 101. This is my new free 30-day course providing one lesson a day on each nutrient delivered straight to your inbox. It can go to your email or it can go to your Facebook Messenger. If you get the Messenger version, it's taught by Chris Masterbot, my baby bot. It's more interactive. There are more emojis and there are more jokes. But both email and Facebook Messenger are incredibly educational. Each lesson covers why the nutrient is important to your health, how to know if you have too little or too much or the wrong balance with other nutrients, how to get it from food, and when you should think about supplementing. It is not a technical or advanced course. It is completely minimum in its technical jargon, and it is designed for the beginner with no background in nutrition and no background beyond high school in the basic sciences. Nevertheless, many people who have backgrounds in nutrition are saying that it is an amazing refresher course full of nuggets of valuable information in each lesson. Sign up completely free by Facebook Messenger or by email at chrismasterjohnphd.com/101. This episode is brought to you by Testing Nutritional Status, the ultimate cheat sheet. This is my recipe to empower you to banish any deficiency or nutritional imbalance from your body. I've been through the pain of my teeth falling apart, my stomach being in constant pain, and my OCD going off the rails during my stint with veganism, to the point where panic attacks were the norm and I was afraid to eat any of the food in my house. I've been through the path of healing using nutrient-dense animal foods to nourish all the systems of my body and become a new person. But I've also learned that my needs change over time. The red meat and liver that were so healing in my recovery from veganism later started sapping my energy and brain power, only to find out that I'm genetically predisposed to iron overload and need to manage it with blood donations. And I've learned from friends, colleagues, and clients that everyone is different. Your needs are not mine. Mine aren't what they were 10 years ago. yours won't be what they are now in 10 years. That's why we need a precise recipe to know exactly what's missing, exactly what's overloaded, exactly what's imbalanced, and an action plan to fix things, and a way to measure our success. That's what I've done with Testing Nutritional Status, the ultimate cheat sheet. Get your copy at chrismasterjohnphd.com/cheat sheet and use the code LITE20, that's L-I-T-E and the number 20, LITE20 to get 20% off. For ad-free versions of these episodes with transcripts that you can read and getting early access to the episodes, often weeks or maybe even months ahead of time, you can sign up for the CMJ Masterpass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code LITE10 to get 10% lifetime discount. The audio of this episode was enhanced and post-processed by Bob Devodian of Torian Mixing. You can find more of his work at torianonlinemixing.com. All right, I hope you found this useful. Signing off, this is Chris Masterjohn at chrismasterjohnphd.com. This has been Chris Masterjohn Lite, and I will see you in the next episode.